Hello, I'm Martin Willett, and I'm going to show you all about who I am and how I know. This is ancestry.co.uk, the website, and this is one of the latest ancestors I've been working on. As you can see, his name Richard Walker, born in 1752. And he died in 1835, and I know that because I found his grave. How I found his grave is quite interesting. Can't remember all the details, but I was looking for, I was looking for my furthest back ancestor on the pure female line, and I knew who she was, and I wanted to know a bit more about her. And I got some kind of a hint that I might find the answer in Martin Churchyard, and I just turned up and I absolutely bang on hit pay dirt, as they say, because I found a couple of graves which absolutely were perfect, exactly what I was looking for, and I tied up some ends and got myself some more ancestors. So Richard Walker, I've got his gravestone here. Let's have a look. I've got it in the gallery. Right. Okay. There we go. It is actually the bit at the top is quite sad. It's the grave of a small child, John, the son of Peter and Mary Walker of Martin, who departed this life November the 4th, 1748, aged 7 years. Okay. So a bit of a family tragedy there, but because of that, they did get a nice big gravestone, and they tied him into the location, and the parents squeezed in at the bottom of the stone there. So we have Hannah Walker and Richard Walker, who were the parents of this little boy, John. I'm not related to the little boy, John, obviously, because he died age 7, but I am related to his elder brother, who wasn't born until little John was already in this grave. So I am related to Richard Walker, who was the son of this Hannah Walker and Richard Walker. And I know this because here, this gravestone here, that's why I know. Because I was looking for, let's have a look, let's see if I can find what I'm looking for here. Let's see, view Richard Walker in the tree. Okay, there's Richard Walker, and just this morning I found a little bit more information about Richard Walker. Basically, I found his parents, both of them, and also his grandparents. So quite a productive morning. A side effect of my car battery going flat, I had to put my battery on charge, and I thought, oh, while I'm doing it, while my battery is charging up, I'll just go and have a little dig at the ancestors, and I dug up three new ancestors, no, four of them, and got quite a bit of detail here. Anyway, where are we? Right, so Richard Walker, let's dig up Richard Walker here. Is that the one I'm looking for? No. Okay. Let's go that way. Ah, here we go. Right. Now then, quite striking there is this bit here. Now this is the oldest photograph in my collection. Well, the oldest photograph in my family collection. And let's bring that up full screen. So I have this photograph, very hard card with that image on it, and there it is, Mary Henshaw, age 50. So that was the oldest ancestor that my grandparents were aware of, because they actually had this photograph. They didn't really know too much about where she came from, and until recently, neither did I. But by going to Martin Churchyard, I found the grave, which got everything into it. Okay, on the subject of graves, here is... There we are, Mary. So she's actually buried there. James Henshaw and Mary, his wife. So we knew about this. This was family history. We knew about James Henshaw and we knew about Mary. And somewhere in the box of memories, box of photographs and things, the name was there of Mary Leah. But I didn't see that until I had already worked it out and found it out for myself that that was her name. Okay, and let's go back to the facts for this Mary Leah. So born in 1815 in Adswood, and because she was of that generation, we do have lots of records via the census. We've got the census of 1841, 1851, 1861, 1871. We don't have a census beyond 1871 for very good reason, because we don't have her beyond 1871. We don't have her in 1881 because she dies in 1877. Okay, so let's have a look at these censuses. This is where we get all the information from. Let's go for the most recent of those, because that will show the sort of information most clearly. Okay, it comes into focus, and then we look at it and we go, ooh, what's this? Trying to make head or tail of it. Okay, what I'm looking for here is Henshaw. And okay, here we go. Mary Henshaw, head of the family, W, so widowed. And age of females, is that 54? Yeah. Is that 54 or is it 64? Ooh, can't read. So blacksmith's shop employ. Okay, so she employs people in the blacksmith shop, because her late husband was a blacksmith. Now, I'm not sure if it's just this family, but I do get the impression that blacksmiths do not live very long lives, because all the blacksmiths in the Henshaw family, and there are an awful lot of them, they all seem to die early. Very few of them make it to the age of 60. Right, so with her in that family, we have William, J, and that's ditto, so that's William J. Henshaw. Okay, two men and two apprentices. So it looks like he is the actual blacksmith, so he's the son of Mary, and he's actually doing the blacksmithing work there. And also living with them is Grace, one of the daughters, and Joseph, who at this stage is age 15, and he's the apprentice. Joe, Uncle Joe, yes, we know about Uncle Joe, because I know all about Uncle Joe. Where do we go? Let's have a look at Uncle Joe. There we go. Here's Uncle Joe, Joseph Henshaw. And we have photographs of Joseph Henshaw from the family collection. There we go. I think this is the most recent photograph. There he is. Typical blacksmith. Never see him without his arms exposed. And yeah, he looks like a blacksmith. And there's his daughter, who looks quite sweet. Okay, and that's Water Lane, Wilmslow. That's where the family come from. Or that's where this part of the family come from. Uncle Joe. And where is he now? I know exactly where he is now. I could take you to him right now. He is right next to my mother in the churchyard. Okay, and here is Joe Henshaw with Grace. Now, Grace is, they're brother and sister of Anne Henshaw, who was my grandmother's grandmother, I think. Certainly like the oldest one in the family that she was aware of personally. So I do have sort of connections there. Now then, this is a vitally important document here from our family details, which has made an awful lot of things easier to look at, because it is it's confirmed from our end that the information that we find on Ancestry is not just random, and it's not just coincidence that it happens to be similar sounding names, but they are actually related to us. And this information has been found useful by these people here. Let's see, obviously that's me, and who's that? Okay, yeah, I know him, sort of. Who's that? Not quite sure who that is. And that, okay. And another one who wishes to remain. Oh, yes, I do know Stuart Hobson. He is definitely related. So we have Hobsons here. We have, here we are, Elizabeth Ann, who was the tallest of the sisters, and she married Arthur Hobson, who was also a tall gentleman. So we have a very tall family of Hobsons who come out from that line, which I'm not going to go into now, because I can basically, with this stuff, you can go off in all directions and you could spend forever on this. But look at this, we've got sons and daughter of James and Mary Henshaw. Anne, born September the 8th, 1836, baptised in Macclesfield. Married to Levi Brown of Wilmslow. Okay. We do know exactly where Levi Brown is, because I've seen his grave many, many times. Okay, and then over on this side, this is a generation further back, which is basically as far back as the family history went. Daniel and Elizabeth Henshaw. Now, I really want to find Daniel Henshaw's grave. I keep meaning to go and have a look for it, but I've not done it yet. Got a pretty clear idea of where it is, or at least where it is to within a couple of hundred yards. But actually finding the stone, I've yet to do. But there's always time. Maybe there isn't. I should have found that before my mother died, so I could have showed it to her. Anyway, never mind. Right, so we have this information here, which is wonderful. This is absolutely fantastic information here. We've got these dates, birth dates, so we could put in information into the family tree, which wasn't available from the records of censuses and so on. Okay, let's have a look at a census. This is a 1911 census for Uncle Joe. Let's have a look. Here we are. Joseph Henshaw, age 55. He's probably doing well at that point. I don't think he lasted much longer. Master blacksmith. He's an employer. He is at home, yeah. So he's basically, yeah, home business. And then we have Sarah Henshaw, his wife. And this is really, really good information here. Particulars as to marriage. So Sarah Henshaw had been married to Joseph for 20 years. They had two children both alive and two children still living, which is great information that really makes it a lot easier to check doing family history when it's got more depth of information like that. James Henshaw, the son, 19, single at the time, grocer's apprentice. A worker, not an employer. And Jessie Henshaw, daughter, 17, single. remember the photo of the attractive girl, Jessie. So that photograph must have been quite similar age. That was 1911 census. So I would imagine that that photograph was not a million miles away in time from that, probably about 1912. There we are, there's the photo again, just to refresh our memory. So this is wonderful. This is how you match up locations, people, and documents. So there she is, the girl. She was 17 in 1911, and she's not a million miles away from that age there. Okay, estimated there 1913. I'm not sure what information I used to make gate 1913 on there. It might have said it on the back, but we certainly have absolutely no reason to believe that isn't true. So that's 1913, so she'd be about 19 on that picture, which explains a lot. Okay. Right. Also a little bit of important information you can have here, because I've got the slightly more expensive form of this. I can actually look into probate records as well. So there we are. Joseph Henshaw of Ottingham Road, Wilmslow, Cheshire, died 17th of January 1929. Oh, actually he was bucking the trend there. He was bucking the trend certainly for Henshaw's. Probate declared in Manchester 12th of February to Sarah Henshaw, his widow. Yeah, that all matches up with the information. Look at that, £182.15. Not a rich man, not a rich man. But rich enough to get a gravestone, which is okay. Right, let's go back into the tree. So what this involves is really constantly working at the interface of the known and the unknown. So here we go, interface of the known and the unknown. Here is some information of this chappy here, Martin Lear, who was the brother of Mary. Now Mary, let's double back. I'll show you the great piece of detective work here, because I thought something was in Martin Cemetery, and then I found this gravestone, which is probably the best day's work I've had on Ancestry, which was finding this. That's it. So I was looking for the link. I could not have found anything better than this stone. I've got it transcribed here. In memory of Anne, wife of Joseph Lear of Broken Cross, Macclesfield. Ding, 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 ding. Exactly what we were looking for. We knew that Mary Lear, we knew her her mother was called Anne, and here he is, and the father was Joseph. So we've got exactly what we're looking for. And it also gives the relationship to the next generation, which is absolutely fantastic. Richard Walker. So basically the father was sort of, you know, involved in burying the daughter there, or at least with the father's family. So she wasn't buried with her husband, so she was buried separate. It's a slightly complicated story there. I think the reason for that is that Joseph Lear marries again, so he'll be buried with his second wife. I'm thinking he'll be probably buried in Gawsworth. So there we are, we found Anne, and straight away I'm always looking for the furthest generation back, the furthest generation back. I'm always trying to work on the pedigree, so how far back you can go. So as soon as I found that, that's great, I found Anne. Now then, this Richard Walker, a generation further back, that was where the interest moved. So I then moved on to Richard, which didn't have to move very far, because that is literally in the next grave. You can see that stone there is the stone we looked at earlier. Okay, so that's that. So there's Anne Walker, born about 1791, and died. There we go. Right. Let's go back to the tree and see what else we can do. Right, so yeah, let's do a little bit of work on the interface between the known and the unknown. So we have here Martin Lear. Let's just refresh my memory so we're not going to do anything stupid with these hints. So we've got him being born in Broken Cross, Macclesfield. Five sources to say that. So we've got lots of information here. Census is 1841, 1851, 1861, 1871, 1881. Okay, we haven't got a death date for him, but we shouldn't really be looking for one before 1881, so we really would like to find a death date for him in the 1880s would be ideal, wouldn't it? Let's see what the hints show us. Okay, so hints for this, and okay, children, Arthur Thomas, oh there we go, Arthur Thomas Lee, yep, okay, that's correct. So this is basically the information for the christening of his child there that we know about, so this is probably good information. It doesn't tell us anything up front, there's no image there to look at. We've just got to have a look at, what does that link to? Let's just try opening up and see if it shows anything. Okay, no, it doesn't, just does it in a different relationship. So let's have a look at the actual thing, what it comes up to. Right, okay, so here we go. This is the nuts and bolts of how we do ancestry. In the modern day and age, we don't actually go out and do a lot of actual research. And I've never once put on a pair of white gloves looked at an old musty document, because these days you don't really need to do that. Or at least you can get an awful lot done without doing that. How much can you get done? Just a quick look. Here is my pedigree chart that I've managed to do largely with the help of Ancestry. There we are, that's down to 25 generations. You've maybe heard of the idea of dock dropping. Well, here we go, here is my GEDCOM pedigree chart for 25 generations. So that sort of tells you who I am. And I think this is the earliest one here, Sir Robert Adlington de Lee. Born about 1293, Knutsford, Cheshire. That's as far back as I go. I'm sorry, I maybe could try a bit further back, but basically anything further back than that, you might as well say you got dragons there, because all this information here, all these links, any one of them can be wrong, and it's a little bit fairy tale stuff. Yeah, it's nice to see it, but I can't really be sure of every one of these steps. One little misstep and it all unravels, so I'm not going overboard on that bit there. I do know this bit here. Sarah Ann Green. The reason I know that is what matters in doing family history. It's the intersection of documents and oral history. So I do know that there was a story of a gentleman, it was a carpenter of some description, I think the story was, who was going round, and he went back to an inn, and he was told to make a cradle, and he asked, so who's the cradle for? It's for thee, lad, it's for thee, because last time you're around you put our daughter in the club. And anyway, so we do know that Sarah Ann Green, our daughter of the publican of a pub in Mobley, was part of the tree. So anyway, found all of that, found this William Green, found his son, found all his voting documents, so we know all about William Green. And then later I found his grave, so we know that. Found all the details, found maps of tithe maps and so on that show what land he owned. So that bit absolutely nailed on. That part of it we know. This part over here, yeah, it's all a little bit airy-fairy, and it may or may not be true. Right, anyway, where was I? This is the bit I was up to. Right, so I'm going to put this information in for Mary Lear, Marty Lear, Uncle Martin. Right, okay. Mary, yep, that's right, that matches up, and that matches up there. So we have a baptism date for that. Okay. There's a little bit of sort of topping and tailing that you have to do when you get these hints. Sometimes they add new information, really important information. Sometimes it's just relatively minor. So have a look at all those children there. Right, and here they are. I love you, Uncle Martin. You're very, very good. You took all your children to be baptized. So we have lots of information to confirm them. So thank you very much, Uncle Martin. Great, 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 great Uncle Martin, however many greats there should be. Okay, there we go. Martin Lear. Wife Mary, yep, and child Harry. Henbury, Cheshire, yeah, that all makes perfect sense. The right part of the world. Age looks right. That, we also know 1869, that all confirms it. All good stuff. So that's more information. This is basically, I know these names probably because I got them off the census in the first place. So I'm basically now finding baptism records that confirm what I've already found from census records. So this is really what we've got here. So this is Arthur Thomas Lear. Okay, another one. He was a busy chap, this Martin Lear. Lots of children. Don't know how many of these survived, but we certainly had some. Yep, that's it, that's fine, and that's all good. Yep, nothing clashing there. Henbury, that's where we want it to be. That's where we last knew him. Okay, Theophilus. Oh wow, that's interesting. For the love of God. Mary Theophilus. Alright, okay, this bit is very boring, I've got to say. Very, very boring. Theophilus, oh, we made it into 1924. And what have we got here? Another one. It seems to be the same event. Have we got it from a different thing? Right, this one, America. We really do need to be very careful about that one. That probably is just a coincidence of the name. So we'll be very careful on that one. But this one is probably just saying the same thing. Maybe a different record coming in from a different source. Not paying too scrupulous attention to this because it's not really going to throw anything off too much, because it's already confirming what we already know. So it's just putting more information in there, just tying all the ends down. Okay, and we have a marriage in 1849. Okay, let's have a look if that clashes with the information we've got here. Earliest child born, 1852. If married in 1849, that is completely respectable Victorian behaviour. So I'm entirely happy to believe that. Okay, now then, this looks like it's written in oldie worldy pen. Okay, there we go. And Leah. What am I looking for? Oh, there we are. Like I see it first, there we are. M A M-A-R-T-I-N, Martin, Macclesfield, absolutely where it should be. Henbury is a little village on the outskirts of Macclesfield, so that will be registered there. So yeah, that absolutely does match. Fourth quarter of 1849. So yeah, sometime between October and December 1849, he got married. And by the look of it, he didn't need to. Marriage place, St George Sutton, Cheshire. Interesting. Wouldn't have expected that, but never mind. There you go. That's fine. There's no reason. Oh, yeah, we've got St George Sutton, that's it. And it just, we know this document confirms it to be Macclesfield. Sutton is part of Macclesfield anyway. Okay, so if he went to Sutton to get married, that's probably because his wife was living in Sutton. Probably the way, that's probably her church. His church is probably more over Broken Crossway, which, if you don't know Macclesfield, doesn't mean much to you. But as I do know Macclesfield, I know what I'm talking about. It's always good when you're looking at the right stuff. Now then, what did I see there? Did I see something that looked very, very wrong? Open Shore, Lancashire. Is that really correct? Let's have a look at this. He moved from Macclesfield and he went to Lancashire. Let's just double check that we've not got some bum information there. Okay. Martin Leah, head of the family. Yeah. Can't quite make out the age. His wife's clearly 39. That's probably 39 behind the crossings out. Carpenter and joiner, Cheshire, Macclesfield, place of birth. Yep. And his wife, place of birth, is that Poynton? Yep. Okay, so that's fine. So maybe that is correct. So for some reason he moved out of the Macclesfield area and did go there. Fine. Okay, so is that one hint left? Let's see what the final hint is. In 1942, he lived in Buffalo, New York. He was born in 1831. In 1942, he was in Buffalo, New York. I think I'll basically tell that, fuck off. Very, very unlikely to be true. I'm not even going to look any further with that one. Right, okay. Right. I could do those, but that will only bore you to tears, so I won't. Right, what else could I do? Oh, hang on, a bit of work to be done here. It suggests that this person here is living. So just have a quick edit there. And I have now killed my seventh great-grandmother. I have killed her. I only knew of her existence this morning, and I've now killed her. Now then, what's it saying? This hint is almost certainly not going to be of any bloody use at all. Yeah. Oh, there's an England flag. Should I put an England flag on her? When she was born in Bolton Le Mars, Lancashire. No, she wasn't. And there's a ancestry tree hint here, which is almost certainly of equally useless information. Okay. No. Okay, this Martha is almost certainly not Mary Latham. Or Mary Latham. Why on earth? No, I think all of those are complete bollocks. So I'm not going to take those hints because they're not very useful at all. So let's ignore those, ignore that, and ignore that. Okay, so where do I go now? Well, let's see. What can we do in the tree? Okay. Right, there's Mary Leah. And then here's the family of the Henshaws. Now, this is where things get complicated and interesting and rich in detail, because we do have lots of information here that matches up with stuff. Now, here is the star of my ancestry, Levi Brown. Now, his story is fantastic. You could write a book about this chap, and one day I may well do just that. In fact, my granny started to write the book, so what I might do is actually take her book and write that and finish it off for her. Okay, so here he is. Let's have a look at him in all his Victorian splendour. There he is. That's quite a substantial Victorian gentleman. Levi Brown. And here is a photo, one of the biggest photos in our collection. This is taken about 1900. That's not too clear. Actually, I've got a better version of that photograph. It looks like everyone's blurred, which is wrong, because actually every face there is perfectly sharp, with one exception, which is this gentleman here, who is Levi Brown himself, because basically this is his workforce. That's his eldest son, that's his eldest son's daughter, and all these people here are his employees. So everybody's keeping perfectly still, and then Levi nods his head, and of course, because Levi nods his head when he's ready to take the picture, he's the only one that's not in focus. That's the way it goes, eh? Okay, yes, that's Annie Brown and James Brown. James Brown is a very interesting chap. Could have more information on this. This here is Hawthorne Hall. You might think, ooh, is that his house? No. But he had recently renovated it. He is a builder, a master builder. And this was basically his masterpiece. He had renovated this hall, and he'd done such a brilliant job. He'd made it absolutely perfect, and he didn't even take the ivy off. The before and after looked, you know, it was just like half falling down, covered in ivy, and then it wasn't falling down at all, still covered in ivy. Looked fantastic. So I've got to say, hats off to the gentleman. Very, very good work. So this is where he ended up. That's St. Bartholomew's Churchyard, Wilmslow. You can see there Levi Brown, top name there. And then there's his wife, Anne Brown, who was Anne Henshaw. And then George Brown underneath, that is his son-in-law. Bertha Brown, his daughter. Annie Brown, who is my great-aunt, who is Bertha Brown and George Brown's daughter. You may think, Bertha Brown, George Brown, what's the connection there? Yes, George Brown was not related to Levi Brown, but just happened to have the same surname. As far as we know, there is no connection. Okay, I was saying about the story. This is part of the story that my granny wrote. My grandfather Levi Brown was born in 1832, and at 7 years old walked from a little cottage near Lindo Common to work at the mill. There he met Anne, who was to become his wife. Levi was very ambitious and hardworking. He decided to learn a trade and become the founder of the well-known firm of Browns of Wilmslow, then known as Levi Brown, builder and contractor. I never knew him, but according to my mother, he was a most highly respected self-made man. He attributed his success to an early training at Greg's Mill. My earliest recollection are Sunday evening walk with my parents around Greg's Mill. I am now in my 80s and still live within walking distance. Beautiful, beautiful. So yeah, my granny is very, very proud of being the granddaughter of Levi Brown, who basically started off as an apprentice in the mill and became an extremely well-respected gentleman. And this is his house. The Rookery, Station Road, Wilmsdale. So there is Levi Brown. That's Anne, who was Anne Henshaw, who was the eldest of the Henshaw girls. That's there. And then that is Annie Brown, who is James Brown's daughter. So that's granddaughter to Levi Brown. And this is Bertha Brown, who is my great grandmother. Okay, so that's Wilmslow, which is the home, really. I suppose that's probably the best way of saying it. What can we say? Some information here that we've gleaned. What's this? What am I looking for? Levi Brown on here somewhere. B for Brown. Is it B for Brown? Commercial. There we go, Brown. Levi, builder and contractor, Station Road, Wilmslow. This is UK directory 1896, so that's all the people. And some of those names look familiar as Wilmslow names, and almost all of them are. Okay, so family history, social history, and you all tied in documents, photos, it all, you tie it all in. And what's this? Oh yes, very important. 1881, he was allowed to vote. Not everybody was that time. And this is the property property qualifications of the various people here. So Levi Brown, there we go. Levi Brown, electoral number 6744. Place of abode, Water Lane, Wilmslow, freehold land of Nursery Lane and with John Shatwell, tenant. So John Shatwell. Now yeah, let's go off in a tangent here. John Shatwell was married to Grace Henshaw. Remember Grace Henshaw? With photograph just showed you a few minutes ago. Are you paying attention here? Grace and Uncle Joe Henshaw. Yeah. There's Grace Henshaw. So this chap here, John Shatwell, was married to Grace Henshaw, he was the tenant at that stage of Levi Brown in Wilmslow. Okay, and this is interesting. Dora Shatwell. Yeah. Let's have a look. Dora Shatwell. Yeah. I thought that was the one. Okay. My first cousin, 3 times removed. And knowing about John Shatwell, and obviously the name Shatwell, it sort of sticks out and you sort of notice it. So I was in the churchyard and I caught the glimpse of the word Shatwell, and that drew my attention to this because I actually had my phone with me with the Ancestry app on it. I could actually find the John Shatwell and Dora and tie it all in. So there we are, a little tragic story of 2 years, 5 months tragedy. So he buried his little daughter here in Wilmslow, and because of that dying there, that's why we now get Look Grace. So this is actually not just the grave of poor little Dora Shatwell, who died 2 years, 5 months, but it's also the grave of Grace, who is Grace Henshaw, who is my, hang on, who is it? Let's bring it up and let's have a look. So my third great aunt. There we are, Grace Henshaw. Let's have a look. Photos of Grace Henshaw. Oh yes, this is great. Now this photo just reminds me of Wallace and Gromit. Now then, what can you say about that photo? There is Grace Henshaw, who at the time would have been Grace Shatwell. And there is Alice Ann Shatwell, who mysteriously never married. Now, what can you say? You know, a motorbike riding lady who never marries. Mystery, complete mystery, that one. Okay, so there you go. There's Jo Henshaw with Grace. We've seen that photo before. And there's the Henshaw sisters. And I think I did say something about Elizabeth Ann Henshaw marrying Hobson, being the tall one. There we are, the tall one. So that there is Elizabeth Ann Henshaw. And these are Henshaws. I could tell Elizabeth Ann because she is relatively smart looking. The others are uniformly battle axes. There you go, what can you say? Formidable looking ladies, formidable looking ladies. And that's Grace Shatwell. That's a slightly better portrait taken by a professional photographer. Doesn't look quite so bad there. Not quite as much of a battle axe. And now here is a family photo of the Shatwells. So that's Grace, yes. And then we've got Alice, George Shatwell, Edith Shatwell. So that's Alice, the one who never marries. That's George, and that's Edith, and that's Mrs. Hall, who that's Grace. That's Grace. Grace Henshaw, who became Grace Shatwell, who then became Grace Hall because she married again. Okay. So these are family photographs which tie up with the information in the documents, which is absolutely terrific. Now then, let's have a look at this. This is the back of a photograph. There we go. Grace Shatwell, née Hall, née Henshaw. So that all ties up. And with dear love and all good wishes for a bright, is that? And happy Christmas, Grace. 1912. Okay. Interesting. And let's have a look at the census we have here. ...1911 Wales census for Grace Hall. Grace Hall, who was Grace Shatwell, who was Grace Henshaw. 57-year-old widow. Manageress of a hotel. Worker. Okay, so she wasn't... she wasn't owning the hotel. But she had experience of hotels with her second husband, or was it her first husband, or maybe it was both, I don't know. Anyway, there you go. And Alice Anne Shatwell, the daughter, 28, single, still single, Alice, I wonder why, and assistant at home. So she's basically helping out around the hotel as a doing housework duties in the hotel. And date of place of birth for both of those is Wilmslow in Cheshire, and language spoken. Oh, that's interesting. If able to speak Welsh or both. Grace Hall and Alice Shatwell were both English speakers, but they had a servant from somewhere or other, Denbighshire, does it say there? Clanwurst, Denbighshire, who could speak both English and Welsh. Right, fascinating information. First time I picked up on that bit there. Right, okay, so what do we do with all this stuff? You just keep constantly working at the boundary between what you know and what you don't, and add a little bit more. And the more you've got, the more information you can do, you can make better use of it. Now, this is a fascinating bit here. As in passing, let's see what we've got for this chap here. Ernest Levi Brown. This is definitely the case of the family history. We knew of Ernest Levi Brown. At one time, when I was sort of a mind to speculate about sort of science fiction things, I would think, what would I do if I had access to a time machine? And what I would do is save the life of this little boy here, which would improve the life of my entire family, and simultaneously erase me from existence. So I consider that as being a wonderful bit of good work that I could do. Hey ho. Right, what the story is here, let's have a look. Very tragic, very, very tragic. So here is the photograph of Ernest Brown and Bertha Brown. Ernest Levi Brown, so he's the son of Levi Brown, and there's Bertha Brown, who is my great-grandmother. So, pictured next to each other at school, that's a school photograph. I wish I had the original. I think it was sent off to the fucking newspaper, and the bastards didn't send it back. I will see if I can get the original back, if at all possible. Anyway. And I found this grave stone in St. Bartholomew's churchyard. Obviously the first thing that I noticed there was the name Henshaw, and I thought, oh, Ernest Henshaw. But that isn't the surname. Ernest Henshaw, that is the first Christian names. Ernest Henshaw, son of Levi and Anne Brown. So that's Levi Brown and Anne Brown, who was Anne Henshaw. of Winslow, who died August, can't quite read it on this photo, aged 3 years, yeah. And then also Mary Elizabeth, their daughter, aged three, can't quite make it out. Anyway, so, and then at the bottom, Ernest Levi, their son, who died aged 9. So three children of Levi Brown and Anne Brown. Now you look at that, and clearly that stone is designed to be Levi Brown's gravestone. You can see absolutely clearly. So the space there to put, you know, the father's name, there's the boy. So the idea was he would be burying his boy there, and then he would put it himself in the grave with his child and then his wife under it. But that didn't come to pass because he had to bury three little children in that grave. So there wasn't room for him, and he started off his own grave. Very, very sad. Such was the way in those days. You had two deaths, probably from infectious diseases, of Ernest Henshaw and Mary Elizabeth, Ernest Henshaw Brown and Mary Elizabeth Brown, and then Ernest Levi Brown. Ernest Levi was the one who was killed on the railway. He was following his elder brothers across the railway. The story was that he was going to see a cricket match over in Hough, which is not far away. I can't help picturing this from Castle Rock, Alderley Edge, because from that vantage point you could see where everything was done. You could see where the cricket match would have been. You could see where Ernest would have come from, and you can see the railway. And he crossed behind a train that had just passed into the path of another train, and he ended up being hit by both trains. Utter tragedy. Utter tragedy. Let's have a look. Here's the 1871 census. That probably catches him. Where are we? There we are. Levi Brown. Paternal fee. Oh, look at this. A railway pointsman. So, yeah, the railway's bringing employment, but it also brought death. So Levi Brown was 38, his wife Anne was 34, James Brown, who was to become Wicked Uncle James and the mainstay of Levi Brown's business. And then we have Bertha, the daughter, who was my great-grandmother, and Ernest Levi, a son who was, that's probably 1 month old. Yeah, so just born then, 1871, and he doesn't get to appear on the 1881 census. Oh yeah, so this information says that Levi Brown was a joiner, and he was born in Cheshire, Wilmslow, yeah. But Anne was born in Cheshire, Macclesfield. That's Broken Cross. Yeah, yeah, that's correct. Okay. Right. So, the other element to this is, of course, DNA. Here we have DNA matches. I've only got two of those now. Yeah, there was three of them before. They tried to link me up with these various people. They're all Americans and they're probably not really very connected. I've checked these out before. There's not much to be looked into them. I don't think these people are my direct ancestors. We probably just share some common ancestor before that. Okay, so we have five shared ancestor hints, 39 fourth cousins or closer, and an awful lot more. Okay, so here we have, first of all, it says I'm related to my first cousin Ian Willett. Well, what do you know? That does seem to be the case. Our relationship, well, I've known his mum and cousin all my life, so that's not new information. Confidence of that extremely high, which is good to know. Now then, this information here, very good confidence there for this one here, Taystone. Now, he doesn't give all the information, so I'm not going to show too much, but this chappy here from Wyoming, Laramie, Wyoming, is related to William Croxall and Elizabeth Scattergood. This is on my mother's side of the family. There's me, there's my mother, that's her father, that's grandfather, and then there's a great-grandfather. Go back in one more generation, and then we come to this shared ancestry here. Now, this chap is related to Thomas Croxall. Now, Thomas Croxall is a Mormon. Yeah, Thomas Croxall is a Mormon. Let's have a look if we can find information on that in my that's another one. Let's just go here. Let's find the Croxall. I'll just briefly show that. William Croxall, my great grandfather. Gallery image here. It's a plot. There, that is the grave of William Croxall. Yeah, also in the grave is Elizabeth Tongue, his mother-in-law, and his son Charles Henry Walter Croxall. No stone has ever been put on that grave. Okay. Okay, let's go. Facts for William Croxall, and then here we go. Right, let's go to James Croxall, his father. Yeah, born 1828, Walton on Trent, Derbyshire. Now then, let's go one generation further back to let's view James Croxall in the tree. That'll give us the information we need, I think. Right, so we have James Croxall there. And James Croxall is related to these people here. William Croxall and Elizabeth Scattergood. James Croxall, where are we? As you can see, there is the baby, born 1828. That's the youngest child of this family. And the eldest son is this chappie here, Thomas Croxall. Thomas Croxall, born 11th of October 1812, Branston, Staffordshire, and died Downey, Bannock, Idaho, United States. So he took his family to the United States and joined the Mormons quite late on in his life. When did he go? Sometime around about there. So he was in his 50s perhaps when he went. Something like that. Then he went and he died in January 1877 on either the 27th or the 29th. Possibly died 27th, buried 29th. That's quite possible. Okay, so quite a lot of people in America are related to Thomas Croxall, because he had a family and their family were Mormons, and Mormons have lots of children and lots of grandchildren and lots of great-grandchildren, therefore lots of people alive today who are related to them, including this chappy here, Takesdown, whoever he is, who is my fourth cousin. So we have checked that with Ancestry DNA, so we know that that match does match. But it's not just that match. We also have this match here. William Croxall and Elizabeth Scattergood, yet again, related to them. There we are, Thomas Croxall also. Okay, that's fine. But it gets better, because there's also one more here. Not quite as many, not quite as much shared DNA there. Basically, we are as connected to all of these. They're fifth to eighth cousins, all of them. But some of them have different amounts of the DNA. So that Takestone chappy seemed to have more of the same DNA as we share in common than some of the others. But here's the other one. This one is related via Anne Croxall, and this one is my third cousin once removed, and these are all English. So Anne Croxall, there you go, born in Burton-on-Trent, died in Burton-on-Trent, so they didn't leave, and That family is still in Britain, so it's in England, I think. So I am definitely related, absolutely 100% guaranteed related to this couple here, William Croxall and Elizabeth Scattergood. So I may well at some point set up a group for people who are related to these people here, William Croxall and Elizabeth Scattergood. And then I will find out as much information about these as I possibly can, because I'm sure there is more I can find than I have got at the moment. I need to be absolutely confirm where, particularly where he died. That's not completely sure. But there you go. Okay, so that's some of what we do. On this, and okay, back to the Ancestry home. And if you do not know who your father is, or your granddad, or anything like that, then all you have to do when you pay your money is you get this, and it just basically gives you some vague information about possibly, maybe, where your DNA comes from. Not really a lot of use, and there are ways of spending £100 better than sending off for this kind of information. So if you haven't really got any information as to who your ancestors are already, then doing this DNA stuff probably isn't going to give you a lot of hard, solid information, not of the sort that I've got, because most of the information I've got really comes from already knowing most of the answers, because my family do know who they are, and who their relatives are, who their ancestors are, and it makes it a lot easier. Okay, so there we are. Here is my hang on, I'm showing off too much. Let's cut it down to let's make it 8 generations. I'll cut out. Oh, not logged in. Okay. Right, so GEDCOM Match allows you to upload your ancestry, your family tree, the information you've got, and also your the results of your DNA, and entirely for free, it will check these things for you against various people. Now, I've found somebody who I have a small amount of things in common with, and this is basically checking how related we are. Now, this is an almost random person who I've vaguely matched with on the GEDCOM match, and it looks like this LL Brown. We probably share a most recent common ancestor 6.1 generations ago. Interesting information. What you can do with that, difficult to say. But if that matches up with the family tree that says we think we do share common ancestry back approximately 6 generations ago, then that would be the confirmation of it. This is slightly more detailed with another person. I chose Brown because, as you've heard, I do have two lots of Browns in my ancestry, so there's a reasonable possibility that somebody with a surname Brown could be related to me. But then also, there's an awful lot of Browns who are not related to me whatsoever. Anyway, this one is, let's have a look at the bottom there. Estimated number of generations to most recent common ancestor is 6. So this shows where the matching genes are. The blue bits are matching segments greater than 7 centimorgans. Very technical information here. Basically, a chunk of DNA where there's a lot of matches. There's a big chunk there on chromosome 9. So again, this is what you call doc dropping, doxing properly. Here is my entire fucking genome. There you go. That is my DNA. Read it and weep. But no, I'm not going to give you a phone number because I'm not fucking stupid. Okay. Okay, so that 0.6 seconds to compare all that genome and show the relatedness. So there's one big chunk there. Now, I haven't got one here of somebody more closely related, but I'll do that on another time. Okay, I have run out of. Yeah, I have run out, and I've had enough, and I'm sure you've probably had enough of listening to me, so I shall stop at that point there. And,